In October of 2019, my friend decided her birthday dinner would be at the Cheesecake Factory. Not the one in Glendale, or even the one in the Grove, but the one in Santa Monica. So why was this a problem? Although I lived in North Hollywood, I worked in Atwater Village, so that's where I had to leave from. This meant that I would have to cross about 3/4 of the city's length without a car, for I didn't own one. My plan was to take the 96 bus to downtown LA, from where I would take the Expo Rail Line all the way to the $8 slice of cheesecake waiting for me on the Pacific Coast. However, the bus was very late, with the Metro Next Trip app telling me that I'd have to wait at least 45 minutes. Because of this, I decided to instead take the 180 bus to the Sunset Vermont Red Line station. From there, I would take the Red Line to 7th and Metro, and then take the Expo Line, therefore moving west so that I could move east so that I could move west again.
I thought you said weest!
Weest!
As I rode the Expo Line overlooking the city, specifically the 10 freeway, which was blocked by rush hour traffic, I got an "Are you on your way?" text, which honestly made me want to cry. After all, this 2-hour journey to the Cheesecake Factory was over twice as long as my regular commute, I was tired from my thankless, less than minimum wage job, and I was about to overpay for mediocre American cuisine. Seeing the traffic on the freeway and experiencing the inadequacy of the public transportation system, I asked myself for the 1,000th time, why is LA like this? But LA isn't bad. It's just drawn that way. Part 1. Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Disney's Who Framed Roger Rabbit follows Eddie Valiant, a private eye who chooses to help Toon movie star Roger Rabbit after he's framed for the murder of his boss's rival, Marvin Acme. The movie was adapted from Who Censored Roger Rabbit, a 1981 mystery novel written by Gary K. Wolfe. Less than a year after its publication, Disney CEO Ron W. Miller secured the film rights in hopes that this could become a blockbuster solution to the studio's creative and financial drought. He hired screenwriters Jeffrey Price and Peter S. Seaman to write the script, in which several changes to the source material were made. In the book, Roger is a comic strip character who hires hardened private eye Eddie Valiant to find out why his employers reneged on their promise to give him his own strip. Instead of a comic strip character, Roger Rabbit would now be an animated cartoon star, which meant that his environment would now be Hollywood. Not just any Hollywood, though, but the golden age of the studio system. Additionally, the script took inspiration from 1974's Chinatown, a neo-noir mystery about the California water wars, the dispute surrounding Los Angeles securing water rights in the early 20th century. This meant that the mystery at the center of the script would now tie into a larger conspiracy related to the city itself. The duo, along with Roger's wife Jessica, slowly uncovers a large conspiracy surrounding Acme's murder, which involves a corrupt judge, the neighborhood of Toontown, and the city's main transportation system, the Red Car Trolley. Spoiler alert! Judge Doom, who was in charge of investigating the case, murdered Acme to take over Toontown and raise the neighborhood. Why? Well, he learned the city was planning on building
a freeway!
Freeway? What the hell's a freeway?
And he intended to use the land to cater to it and profit off of it. His plan is foiled, of course, and the Toons get to inherit Toontown from Acme as he had intended. No communities are dipped, no freeways are built, Roger kisses Eddie, the end. Part 2. What is Roger Rabbit about? Who Framed Roger Rabbit premiered in 1988 to widespread critical and commercial success. Not only that, but it was also a technical marvel, showcasing a seamless integration of live-action and traditional animation, the likes of which had not been seen since Mary Poppins 25 years earlier. But we're not here to talk about that. Countless people have talked about how the movie is flawlessly made. And it is! They had Roger bump into a lamp in the speakeasy scene just to show off. It's insane, I love it. But I want to take a look at what the movie's about. It is, of course, a love letter to the golden age of Hollywood, but a really nuanced one at that. More on that later. It portrays the intricacies of the studio system, in which performers and celebrities were brand assets.
It's just Dumbo!
I know who it is.
I got him on loan from Disney.
And comments on the often abusive relationship that stemmed from this dynamic.
The best part is, they work for peanuts.
The backdrop to the main story, though, is that of a company planning to bulldoze an entire inhabited community to capitalize on the construction of
a freeway!
Freeway? What the hell's a freeway?
But they don't want to get rid of any community. It's a Toon community. Part 3. Toons of Color. Content warning, graphic depictions of racism. Toons in Who Framed Roger Rabbit are meant to represent people of color. The movie is not subtle about this.
Toon review. Strictly humans only, okay?
Toons are, essentially, property of the studios where they work. They entertain in venues where they can't be patrons themselves. They are victims of specific microaggressions and prejudices.
Toons.
In short, they are often treated as second-class citizens. They're even subjected to extrajudicial executions, traumatizing a whole generation of children. The studio heads, Judge Doom, and everyday humans are constantly mocking them, using them, and bypassing their agency. They are, in this society, meant to be entertainment commodities to the humans, and nothing more.
Open up in the name of the law!
It's important to know that this allegory doesn't come from nothing. In fact, it's not just a creative thematic choice, but a commentary on the history of animation in and of itself. Early cartoons tended to use racist imagery, everyone knows that. But it actually went a lot deeper than that. Early cartoon shorts would evoke a lot of minstrel imagery, essentially becoming a vehicle for filmic blackface. Minstrel shows, for reference, were a very racist form of live theater entertainment that originated in the United States in the early 19th century. These shows, mostly consisting of comic skits, featured white actors in cartoonish blackface, mocking black people by acting lazy, dumb, and buffoonish. This is where a lot of racist character tropes were popularized, including the infamous Jim Crow. These outlived minstrel shows and permeated into film as the new medium came to be, obviously in live action, but also in animation, where certain signature features of minstrel shows were recycled. Even when they didn't feature explicitly racist imagery, a lot of cartoon characters evoked a minstrel-like attitude when they performed for audiences. All this to say that the parallels between Toons in Who Framed Roger Rabbit and people of color, particularly black performers, are not just deliberate. They are a part of the thematic core of the movie.
I don't work for Toons.
But what does any of this have to do with the 96 bus being late, the 10th freeway being jam-packed, and me dreading having to go any farther than Fairfax for anything? Part 4. Destroying Toontown. Let's go over Judge Doom's plan. What exactly does he want?
I see a place where people get on and off the freeway. On and on, all day, all night!
Judge Doom learns about plans for a freeway, specifically one that will pass by Toontown. So he murders Marvin Acme, its legal owner, to take over the land, aided by the fact that he seems to have left no will. His intent? To profit off of the freeway.
Soon, where Toontown once stood will be a string of gas stations, inexpensive motels, restaurants that serve rapidly prepared food, tire salons, automobile dealerships, and wonderful, wonderful billboards reaching as far as the eye can see.
He doesn't care about benefiting people, he's thinking about the business opportunities that will spring along. The people don't need a freeway. As Eddie says,
nobody's gonna drive this lousy freeway when they can take the red car for a nickel.
So, through Cloverleaf Industries, a shell company, Judge Doom buys the red car with the intention of dismantling it. Pretty insane, right? I mean, who would do this? Who would sabotage the main public transportation system, either by making it unusable, inaccessible, or extinct, in order to essentially create the artificial need for
a freeway? Freeway? What the hell's a freeway?
What indeed, Eddie? What the hell's a freeway? Part 5. Who needs a car in LA? The red car trolley is not an invention of the movie. Officially known as the Pacific Electric Railway Company, it was a real public transportation system that served Los Angeles and its surrounding communities throughout the first half of the 20th century. As the area's main means of transportation, it connected cities in 4 different counties. In the 1920s, it was even the largest electric railway system in the world. Now, despite being public transportation, however, the company was privately owned, created in 1901 by railroad executive Henry E. Huntington and banker Isaias W. Hellman. The story of the railroad's inception is very complex, but in short, both of these men controlled large real estate development operations in the city and in its nascent suburbs. The railroad wasn't planned as a service for the common good of the people. It was more of a way to transport people between these men's properties so that they could profit off them. After all, if there was a way to get to the suburbs, then people would actually want to live there, and then the property could be developed. That's where the money really was. In fact, the railway barely generated any profit. The system was a loss leader, meaning that it was priced below market cost so that it could better stimulate the real estate ventures. These rich assholes basically benefited from the trolley operating properly, which is why it had such complete reach and, at the height of its glory, full service. As author James Howard Kunstler put it, the railway company connected all the dots on the map and was a leading player itself in developing all the real estate that lay in between the dots. A map of the railway is almost enough to make me cry at the thought of not having to transfer three times to get anywhere outside the valley. Like, there's nothing worse than having to switch buses at the Hollywood and Highland intersection, which you have to do if you want to get even close to the west side, and tourists shove you around, and Superman asks if you want a picture, and Scientologists are trying to recruit you, and everything smells, and the 217 bus is nowhere to be seen, and... Never go to Hollywood Boulevard. The memory of such an efficient and convenient system even becomes nostalgic, with Eddie Valiant himself remarking upon it.
Who needs a car in LA? We got the best public transportation system in the world.
However, as Tom Anderson states in his 2003 documentary Los Angeles Plays Itself, in 1947, many would have disagreed with Eddie Valiant's endorsement. Complaints about overcrowding, slowness, discriminatory pricing, and poor service had been endemic for more than 30 years. What caused the decline? Well, as always, profit. Huntington, majority stock owner of the Pacific Electric Railroad Company, decided that once most of his suburban property had been developed, running the trolley was too unprofitable, especially since most of the people who used it were poor and couldn't really afford to pay more. This is where Judge Doom comes in. Part 6, The Real Cloverleaf. Like Marvin Acme, the red car trolley did not die. It was murdered.
What's with Earl?
Laid off.
A new outfit bought the red car. Some big company called Cloverleaf.
Screenwriter Jeffrey Price said about the development of Who Framed Roger Rabbit, the red car plot, suburb expansion, urban and political corruption really did happen. In Los Angeles, during the 1940s, car and tire companies teamed up against the Pacific Electric Railway system and bought them out of business. Where the freeway runs in Los Angeles is where the red car used to be. Toward the end of World War II, county and state officials were considering building a network of freeways across the Los Angeles area to accommodate post-war traffic. This seemed necessary since the already decaying public transportation and the automobile infrastructure didn't feel like enough. Simultaneously, the entire railway company was sold to American City Lines Incorporated, which was, in turn, a subsidiary of National City Lines, a holding company that was buying several public transit systems across the country. Why? Well, if you thought that Judge Doom's plan was cartoonish, just wait until you hear about capitalism. The main investors of National City Lines were Firestone Tire, Standard Oil of California, now Chevron, and General Motors. What do these companies have in common? Los Angeles Railway slowly phased out trolleys, instead favoring buses that were, you guessed it, purchased from the hauling company's investors.
You see, GE owns Kitchen Oil of Colorado, which in turn owns JMI of Stanford, which is a majority shareholder in PokerFastLane.com, which recently acquired the Shinehart Wig Company, which owns NBC outright. NBC owns Winnipeg Ironworks, which owns the Opchanagi Party Meats Corporation of Pyongyang, North Korea, and they
will destroy your trolley.
Throughout the subsequent decade, bus service became increasingly worse, to the point in which freeways seemed like the best solutions for Los Angeles transportation. Freeways meant that more Angelinos would need cars, which translated into more business for tire, oil, and car companies, the same ones that indirectly owned that and several other transportation systems across the country. It's worth noting that this was a time in urban planning where those in charge had a godlike power and disregard for everyday citizens, especially since New York master builder Robert Moses' ideas about slum clearance were spreading nationwide. This resulted in countless neighborhoods being expropriated in order to build the freeways, and predictably for the United States, most of these were low-income Black and Latinx communities. In fact, planners purposefully rerouted freeways to go through neighborhoods they considered slums. Boyle Heights, which to this day is a racially diverse Latinx neighborhood, was nearly razed when three different freeways were directed through the area. And even though this would cost more, city officials rerouted construction of the Santa Monica Freeway so that it would go straight through Sugar Hill, a thriving black middle-class neighborhood where black Hollywood royalty such as Hattie McDaniel and Louise Beaver used to live. Once again, the community that the biggest black movie stars called home was wiped off the map by a freeway.
Where Toontown once stood will be a string of gas stations!
As described in an LA Times opinion piece on the matter, freeways created physical barriers that made any non-white presence on the white side of the road conspicuous, and thus easier to target by law enforcement. One 1943 freeway marketing pamphlet designed to win over reluctant white communities boasted of the freeway's fortress-like impermeability and ability to preserve neighborhood character. And for those who might think that the freeways were necessary and had to be built, it's worth noting that not all of them were. Affluent white neighborhoods, such as Beverly Hills, successfully fought off the construction of freeways in their area. This resulted in only 61% of the planned system actually coming to term, leaving the freeways that were built often bottlenecked and overwhelmed. Thousands of poor people of color were displaced to make way for freeways that they would most likely not even be able to use. And even if they could have used them, they weren't that great either. Those who were able to stay behind had the socioeconomic fabrics of their lives torn apart, and that's not to mention the health hazards. So, who framed Roger Rabbit again? Part 7. Why is LA like this? I think there's no denying that Who Framed Roger Rabbit plays into a lot of nostalgia. From the use of classic cartoon characters, some of whom had been absent for decades, to the already discussed statements about a better time for Los Angeles. We see this in a lot of studio movies. Hollywood loves to reminisce about its golden age, sometimes to glorify it, sometimes to deconstruct it, sometimes to explore its appeal, but almost always to explore that which we perceive as lost.
I am big. It's the picture that got small,
says Tom Anderson in Los Angeles Plays Itself. The questions began, how did we go wrong? When did we go wrong? Although Los Angeles is a city with no history, nostalgia has always been the dominant tone in the city's image of itself. At any time in its history, Los Angeles was always a better place a long time ago than in the present. I feel like this plays into a larger disillusionment with the American enterprise and their broken promises of a better future. I don't think it's a coincidence that the movie also expresses disappointment with big animation studio moguls either.
I don't believe there's a challenge anywhere in the world that's more important to people everywhere than finding solutions to the problems of our cities.
The post-war boom worked to develop a sense of trust in corporations, for these were promising shiny solutions to everyday problems. The suburban home, the personal car, and, of course, the road to drive it. With a shift in tone, Judge Doom's monologue could easily become a mid-century advertisement, or even a hero's visionary speech in a biopic. What makes it so memorable and at the same time so horrifying is the rhetoric that evokes the way bad ideas are sold to us. It reminds me of how magnates try to convince us that an expensive electric car and not a complete reworking of our infrastructure is going to save us from climate catastrophe. These promises of improvement were just never fulfilled. But how could they? Throughout the movie, Judge Doom has done nothing but show contempt and disregard for toons, and people for that matter, which further downplays any intentions he might have in regards to the freeway. It's not about helping the people, it's about exercising power over them. That's what Roger Rabbit understands, that it doesn't matter whether or not the freeway actually helps the people of Los Angeles, what matters is that Judge Doom has the power to build it. And he would have. As Robert Caro says in The Power Broker, Robert Moses and the Fall of New York, science, knowledge, logic, and brilliance might be useful tools, but they didn't build highways or civil service systems. Power built highways and civil service systems. Part 8. Just drawn that way. There's a particular brand of Los Angeles nostalgia that permeates movies such as Chinatown and Who Framed Roger Rabbit. What was new in the 70s, says Tom Anderson, was a nostalgia for what might have been. A sense that everything might have been different except for one defining event. We began to look for an originary sin. Chinatown took an urban myth about the founding of Los Angeles on water stolen from the Owens River Valley and made it resonate. And we all know how that ended.
Forget it, Jake. It's Chinatown.
Roger Rabbit did the same thing, albeit ending on a more positive note. Instead of resigning to what did happen, Roger and Eddie dared to ask, well, what if the freeway had been stopped? Would that have been enough to save the city? Probably not. In her book, The Death and Life of Great American Cities, Jane Jacobs states that automobiles are often conveniently tagged as the villains responsible for the ills of cities and the disappointments and futilities of city planning. But the destructive effects of automobiles are much less a cause than a symptom of our incompetence at city building. The problems that plague our cities are too pervasive to be solved with a song and some dip. Even if Judge Doom is defeated, well, who knows what the next threat to Toontown will be. Hell, in reality, the capitalist machine had already been destroying the trolley for decades. The movie, however, is not revisionist. It's not whitewashing history or lying to us about what really happened. Rather, it's giving a crazy supervillain plan the crazy supervillain that can do it justice. Unlike other movies with ahistorical happy endings, Roger Rabbit is very aware of what it's communicating. Anyone remotely familiar with Los Angeles knows that when Eddie says,
"Who needs a car in LA? We got the best public transportation system in the world!"
he's winking at the audience. He's winking at me. I don't know if other people think about it this much as they ride the rail over South LA, or as they're stuck on the 101 because of some concert at the Hollywood Bowl, or as they beg for the stupid 183 bus to be punctual for once so they're not late to work again. But I do. I think about the horrible means that led to an end the majority of the city complains about every day. I think about how sad it is to compare today's rail line with what the city had a century ago. I think about this map of LA freeways if they were rail lines. Sorry. I have something in my eye. I think about how much I cherish the areas where you can just walk from one place to the other. I think about the gorgeous city buried underneath the elevated concrete, gasping for clean air and better mobility. I think about Who Framed Roger Rabbit, because it dares to imagine a reality in which Los Angeles doesn't just have a bright past, like so much nostalgic media tells us it had, but also a bright future. It indulges in hypotheticals, sure, like, what if Los Angeles public transportation hadn't been dismantled by monopolistic motor companies that wanted to promote elitist automobile use? What if neighborhoods full of people of color hadn't been bulldozed to build freeways that didn't benefit them? What if those who we value as entertainers could be valued as people as well? But it also encourages future awareness. To once again quote Jane Jacobs, "It is easy to blame the decay of cities on traffic, or immigrants, or the whimsies of the middle class. The decay of cities goes deeper and is more complicated. It goes right down to what we think we want, and to our ignorance about how cities work. Not one person or rabbit can save the city from deeply entrenched systemic issues, but at least we can do something about that ignorance. We can make an effort to be aware of them and how they work. Maybe then we'll recognize the traumatizing villains the next time they show up and do something about them. Not just remember a better past, but also imagine a better future. A future where the 183 bus is on time."
Seriously. What are you seeing that guy?
He makes me laugh.